Good morning, everybody, or afternoon, I suppose now. My day's all messed up. Thank you for coming to join us here. My name's Molly, and I am coming to you from Two Wheel View. We're a bicycle-based organization in Calgary. We do all kinds of stuff with mostly youth and young adults that center around the bicycle. And one of the fun things that we get to do is come and talk to folks about bicycle safety. And so we're going to get started on that today, and we're going to kind of plan to go for a little bit of a ride together today. So if you don't already have some, you're going to need a little bit of a piece of paper and some writing tools to sort of bring with you as we prepare for this ride. So what we're going to do today is we're going to talk a bit about what we would like to wear when we go on a bike ride to be safe, what we need to do to our bike to make sure that it's safe, and what we need to do to the environment around us to make sure that we're safe. So the idea here is that we're gonna just dream a little bit about what it's like to ride our bike safely and try to do a little bit of hands-on stuff as well. So we're gonna start out with, as I said, what we're gonna wear. So if we're thinking about going for a ride, we have to get dressed, and that is going to look different on different days of the year. But what I'd like for you to do is grab a piece of paper and draw a little doodle of yourself, and that will give you a chance to imagine yourself on a ride and add an outfit. So think about what you would wear while you are riding your bike and what you're trying to be addressing from a safety perspective. So think all the way from the top of your head down to the tips of your toes. What kinds of safety items would you wear? What kind of clothes would you wear that would make it safer to go on a bike ride? And give you folks just a couple of minutes to do that, so you can go for that for now. You've gotten up. You're getting ready to go. What do you wear? How do you make safe choices for what to wear on a bike? You can consider what the weather might be like. You can consider how you might be visible to other users around you. You can consider what you might want to wear to protect yourself if you fell while you were riding. What would you like to wear on a bike ride? So I'll give you one more minute to just doodle, and you can keep doodling as we go. We're going to talk about all kinds of things related to this, and so you'll have your piece of paper in front of you. Feel free to doodle or add little notes or things that you've learned as we go, and that will give you a chance to keep learning that way. I'm going to give you some suggestions in a minute here of what I would normally wear or what I might think about before I go for a bike ride, then you can add those things to your little drawing of yourself if you want to afterward. And feel free, we do have somebody monitoring. We've got questions and answers that you can submit a Q&A for. And if you need more time or anybody's got any questions about the activity, feel free to use that feature to check in with us about how it's going. Okay, so as you're continuing to draw your biking outfit, I'm going to start talking about some of Two Wheel View's suggestions. Things that we suggest is considering brightly colored and weather-appropriate clothing. So you can go as far as this individual has and wear a reflective vest, which is great, but just considering brightly colored clothing is a really great option. When we say weather-appropriate clothing, the thing I would like to say is that you can definitely ride your bike year-round. Lots of people do. My bike is my primary mode of transportation, so I ride it to work pretty much every day, and I do so year-round. So weather-appropriate clothing on a day like today is going to be really different than weather-appropriate clothing in the middle of summer. So I'm going to choose clothes that will keep me dry and warm if there's any precipitation. I'm going to choose clothes that will protect me from the sun if it's a really sunny day, and that kind of thing. So weather-appropriate, brightly colored clothing is a great effect. So you could consider adding that to your drawing if your doodle of yourself doesn't have that. other thing we suggest is eye protection. So a lot of times that's just like sunglasses or something like that, but you can get specific cycling goggles or things like that. I have glasses, so I always have eye protection, so that's kind of nice. But yeah, you're wanting to keep the sun out of your eyes, keep bugs out of your eyes, these kinds of things. Gloves are really important. This picture is great because it also contains a kitten. That's not so much a safety equipment, but it is pretty cute. And so gloves are great because they can pad your hands on your handlebars, but they also are going to allow you to protect your palms if you ever skid onto the gravel as you fell or something like that. So gloves are pretty great. Closed-toed shoes with tied laces are pretty good. So take a second and think why we would want to make sure our laces are tied. That would be so that we don't get our laces caught up in our pedals or wrapped into our chain or things like that. It is preferable that you wear closed-toed shoes and not sandals, even when it's sunny out, just in case you fall and scrape up your skin and because those shoes stay on and are a little bit more secure. So as we're considering how to be safe on our bike, we're preparing ourselves for if we accidentally fall, we're trying to make sure we're visible, we're trying to make sure we're warm and comfortable, and that we're not in a position to get ourselves injured or anything like that. Pants and clothes that are not super baggy, or these folks here have little straps around their ankles, which is pretty great to help keep your pants out of your chain. So kind of same as the shoelaces there, it's not super fun to get yourself all tangled up in your chain, could accidentally cause an opportunity to fall. Breathable and quick drying clothes. So it's a little bit weather dependent, but even in the winter time, if it's cold out and you get really sweaty, that can make you really chilly. So breathable clothes that dry quickly are pretty great. And a helmet that fits. So helmets fitting properly is pretty important part of bicycle safety. So that's something to consider as well. So stop and look at your little doodle and see if there's anything that you missed. And there might even be things that you put on your doodle for bike safety that I didn't have. One thing that students often come up with is elbow pads or knee pads. And you could certainly use those, especially when you're learning, or if you are doing tricks at a BMX park or doing technical downhill jumps. But most people who use their bike just for fun and for biking to the 7-Eleven to get a Slurpee or with their friends or just to work or to school or things like that, most people don't need to wear elbow pads and knee pads for those, but that's okay. One thing I wanted to talk about before we change slides is actually how to fit a helmet properly. So what we talk about when we talk about fitting a helmet is doing something called the 2-4-1 rule. And actually, if some folks who are helping me from the back end could just change this to my screen, I forgot to include that instruction, but I'm just going to show these folks a little bit how I would fit a helmet. And so if they could see me, that would be helpful.
There we go. Should switch.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you so much. So when we're thinking about fitting a helmet, if I put my helmet on my head and it falls too forward in front of my eyes, I'm not going to be able to see. If I sit my helmet too far back on my head, then my forehead's going to be exposed. So we talk about the 2-4-1 rule, the 2 in the 2-4-1. So if you're sitting at a desk, you can follow along with this. The 2 is 2 fingers above our eyebrows. So our helmet should fit nicely on our head with only about 2 fingers of space between the top of the helmet and our eyebrows. And then the 4 rule here is that the straps go on either sides of our ears. So you've got four fingers that indicate we put our straps nicely on the sides of our ears. And then the 1 rule is that we will slide 1 finger underneath the strap under our chin. So when a helmet comes closed on your chin, you want it to be tight enough that it'll stay in place, but not so tight that it's uncomfortable, but you should be able to fit about 1 finger in there. So that's the 2-4-1 rule. If we're gonna wear a helmet, which is the law for students and young people like yourselves under 18, it's really important that it fits properly. And the other thing to note about helmets is if they are involved in any kind of a major accident or if you drop them really hard, they start to get damaged. So the way that a helmet works is it absorbs the impact of your fall in the foam that the helmet is made up of. And so if you crash or damage it, the foam's not gonna be able to absorb that impact anymore. So if your helmet is quite a few years old, if it's been dropped a lot, if it's been involved in a major accident, you should replace your helmet. So properly fitted helmet and replacing that helmet somewhat frequently. If you've got any questions, that you can share those too, and we might revisit them at the end if we need to. That is our section on what we would wear while we're riding our bicycle. So now you can go back to your piece of paper and draw a bike. So bikes are a little bit fun to draw, I think. Kind of a unique shape. Do your best. Draw yourself a bicycle. And then brainstorm and label on that bike what you might want to check before riding your bike. So a lot of times when we think about safety and bicycle-related safety, we think about, like, how would I behave while I'm on the bike? And how do I look and listen and be aware of my surroundings? And all of that is a really essential part of bike safety. And is super, super important. But we actually also need to think about making sure our bike is functioning properly as a safety-related issue. So if something wasn't working properly on your bike, it may cause you to have a mechanical incident that could cause you to crash and injure yourself or lose control of your bike or something like that. So what are the types of things that you might want to check over on your bike to make sure it's working properly? I'm just going to give you guys a couple minutes to draw and to do that, but take your time. Think about all the different areas of your bike. Think about things that have commonly gone wrong on your own bike when you've been out on rides, that kind of thing. Is there anything you've ever had happen to you or something's gone wrong with your bike and you've had to walk your bike home or had to get somebody to help you fix it? Those kinds of things. Think about that as you are drawing a picture of a bicycle and labeling some of the things that you might want to check from a mechanical standpoint before you go riding. Yeah, and if you've got any suggestions, definitely feel free to put those in the chat as well. Tell me what you're thinking. Tell me what color you drew your bike. Whatever you want to share in the chat, the option is there for you too. All right, so keep drawing away and keep thinking. While you're thinking about that and writing to yourselves and labeling your bikes, I'd like to make a suggestion on when you would do these kinds of checks. So what I would suggest is that you check over a bike really quickly and just a quick visual check anytime you ride a bike, just making sure that everything's working properly. But doing a more thorough check the first time you ride a bike for a season is really important. So as I mentioned, I ride my bike year-round, but I ride a different bike in the winter than I ride in the summer, and I ride a different bike when I'm mountain biking than when I'm riding in the city. And so if I'm picking out a bike, so it's been kind of wintry for a while, spring's around the corner, if I pull out my spring or summer bike that I ride to work and to the grocery store and stuff, I will do a thorough check to make sure that the mechanics of that bike are working well. Even if I don't know how to fix them or what to do about them, that's okay, because if I identify that my bike is unsafe to ride, I can reach out to people in my life who might know how to fix them, or resources in my community to see if I can address that problem before I ride an unsafe bike. So keep riding, keep brainstorming, keep doodling, make your bike nice and cool looking. And if there's anything I point out that you want to add to your bike drawing, please do so. So what we like to suggest is something that we call the ABC check. So it's a nice little easy acronym for things that we can fix on a bike. I'm not sure if everybody has access to the Q&A box or not, but if you want to share, you can, or you can just guess amongst each other and chat about it for a second. But what do people think that the A might stand for in the ABC check? What kind of things on the bike might the A stand for? Give you a second to guess. If somebody wants to share in the Q&A or anything, they can. But no need if you don't want to. So A stands for air. So A is for air. What, any guesses on what B might stand for on your bicycle? It doesn't stand for bicycle, but what's something you could safety check on your bike that starts with B? This one's pretty important. They're all important, but feel free to use the chat if you'd like. B is for brakes. So brakes are an important thing to check before we go on a bike ride, for sure. And then C, any guesses on what C might be? So you could share out loud with your classmates or try to guess. Any thoughts on what C might be? So this is a common one that I think people, this can sometimes cause people to end up walking their bike home. But C is for chain. So we're going to go through each of these now. So we'll start with A for air. So A is for air or air pressure. So we want to make sure that our tires are holding air and that they are up to the proper pressure. So one of the things that you can sort of do is feel whether your tire feels nice and firm, kind of like a basketball. Different types of tires are going to have different tire pressure limits. So it's going to look different for everybody's, it's going to look different on everybody's bike, but you just want to make sure that your tire is holding air, because if it's not holding air well, you might have a hold, or you might not have enough tire pressure in to have an enjoyable ride. One thing that is important to note is that your tires have inner tubes in them, and the inner tubes are what are holding your air and building up that pressure. And those inner tubes and the tires are a bit porous. So they've got little teeny tiny holes in them. Not something that you can see visually, but on a microscopic level, they've got a little bit of holes in them. So over time, tires will lose air pressure. So if you're gonna do a more thorough ABC quick check at when you start riding your bike, for the first time for the season, it wouldn't be uncommon for me in a couple of weeks when it starts to get nicer, maybe a few more than a couple of weeks, we'll see, I'm hoping it'll be soon, when I pull out my summer bike, if it has flat tires, I'm not going to automatically assume that I have a hole because the air might have escaped slowly out of the bike over time. So I'm just going to try to inflate it up to inflate it up to the suggested pressure, and then I'm going to just make sure it's holding air. I'm also going to spin the wheels to make sure they spin freely and make sure my tires are not worn out. So if you skid on tires a lot or after you wear them for a long time, the rubber can start to wear out and there's something that might need to be replaced. So there we go. So that's A for air. And feel free to ask any questions that you might have about these topics in the Q&A there. B is for brakes, as we said, and this is pretty simple here. We just want to make sure our brakes work. So one of the ways that you could do that is you could ride your bike around on your driveway or on your front lawn or in a nearby park, and don't go too far away from home, and just go slow and test your brakes. But the other things that you can do is that you can hold your handlebars and squeeze your front brake and not be riding the bike, just be holding it. And if you push the bike forward, the front wheel should lock up because you've got the front brake on, and the back wheel should sort of lift up. And then you can do it the reverse to see if the rear brake is working. So pretty simple there. We want our brakes to have the ability to be a gradient. So we don't want brakes to just be on or off. We want to be able to lightly apply the pressure of our brakes in order to stop gradually or slow down. So it's not just an on or off situation. And actually slamming on our brakes and locking up our tires can be an unsafe way to ride bikes that can cause you to fall more easily. I don't know if you folks have heard before, but your front brake is your most powerful brake. And so sometimes when we're talking about safety, people think they shouldn't use their front brake. What's going to happen if I use my front brake? If I slam my front brake on only, I might fly over my handlebars. This is true. If you slam on only your front brake, you might fly over your handlebars and that won't feel great. Luckily, we're wearing a helmet and we're prepared, but I wouldn't say that you should use this as a reason to shy away from your front brake. Your front brake is powerful and strong, and it's there for a reason to help you be able to safely control your bike. What I would say is you want to squeeze your brakes gently, and you can even try doing like on, off, on, off, on, off to like sort of just like feather the brakes a bit, we call it. But I would always use the front brake and the rear brake in combination with each other. And that way your wheels will be slowing down at a similar rate and you don't lock your front tire and you won't have that accidental flying over the handlebars incident that we're always trying to avoid. So those are brakes, pretty fun. Then C is for chain. So you want to make sure that your chain spins freely and that you can shift through all of your gears and those kinds of things are working well. And the other thing we want to do with our chains is we want to make sure that they're clean and rust-free and well lubricated. So if possible, bikes that live indoors end up being in slightly better condition generally. And if a bike has to live outside, we suggest locking it up and putting it under a tarp. Because the elements can be part of what causes a chain to get rusty. You can lubricate your chain with chain lube and a rag and wash your chain with soap and water, and that will help to keep your bike rolling forward. So we want to do our A, B, C quick check to make sure that our bike is nice and safe to ride. Because a bike that's not functioning well represents a safety risk. And even if we're wearing all our proper safety equipment and we're making good and safe choices while we're on our bike, if our bike is broken, that introduces an extra hazard into that system of risk. Okay? So now we're going to go back to our piece of paper, grab your little drawing. Now you should have a person. They're dressed, they're ready to go, suitable for a ride. We've checked over our bike. It's working great. It's dreamy. We've taken good care of it. It's mechanically sound. Now we're going to head out into the world to bike. We're going to bike on multi-use pathways in parks that might have pedestrians and other riders. We're going to bike on trails outside of the city. We're going to bike on Nose Hill or Fish Creek Park. We're going to bike in our neighborhood. You'll see adults and older teens riding their bikes on the road because they're using those bikes as modes of transportation, and bicycles are vehicles under the Alberta Traffic Safety Act. So we're getting out there in the world, and there's lots of things that could go wrong. But when you're riding your bike, I'd like you to think of your top three riding tips. So what are your tips for riding safely? What would you say to somebody who's riding their bike for the first time? What would you say to your friends or your siblings to make sure they might be safe? So draw some doodles or write them down, some kind of representation of your three tips. So if you're having trouble thinking of a tip, you could write down some suggestions based on things that have gone wrong for you before. What are the types of things that might have gone wrong? So some of these tips, which we'll go over in a bit, but some of my favorite tips are things like ride your bike in control and pay attention to your surroundings. But what are your kinds of tips that you would give folks about how to be your absolute safest while you're riding your bike? I'll give you guys a couple minutes, and as always, we'd love to hear your suggestions in the Q&A. And if you've got any questions about anything we've gone over so far, please throw those in the chat box there. Okay, I'm going to go over some of our suggestions, which is great. So one of the things that we like to suggest is that you don't ride alone, and unless you have gotten to the place where you're feeling comfortable with that. And as you get a little bit older, that might change. But for now, it's nice to ride with a friend or with an adult in your life. Keep both of your hands on your handlebars. Look both ways at intersections and driveways. Entrances to parking lots can be sneaky too. And it's always okay to remember that you can walk your bike if that is what feels safest. So you are always allowed to make decisions that make you feel safe, and walk your bike if it feels unsafe. And then I think ultimately the biggest thing is to ride your bike in control and be aware of your surroundings. And so in order to be aware of our surroundings, we want to try to be alert and aware. So avoiding talking on the phone or listening to music in our earbuds when we want to be able to hear things going on around us. We also want to obey all of the traffic laws. So if and when you start to feel ready to ride on the road, or if there's ever any signs or traffic signs on any of the pathways that you're on, we always want to obey the laws of the road and pay attention to our surroundings. Just like on the road with a car, we ride on the right-hand side of the sidewalk and the pathway and the roads. So that's really important. And honestly, we could go on for ages thinking about different hazards that we might encounter and ways that we might want to be safe and things that might go wrong. But really, it really does come down to riding your bike in your skill level, riding your bike in control, and being aware of your surroundings so that you have enough time to react and decide what you're going to do. If you see an unsafe hazard in your sight line, you might choose to slow down and get off your bike and walk. If you see a hill that you're about to go down and you're not very comfortable with that, you might slow your speed down so that you ride in control. You might get off and walk. Being aware of what's going on around us allows us to make decisions that are best for us. And everybody has different skill level and comfort with bikes, and you've got to do what feels the safest and most comfortable for yourself. Bike riding is inherently risky. There are risks associated with it, and that's okay. Sometimes when we are taking risks, we're pushing our skill set and our comfort level, and there's nothing wrong with that. We just want to do so in a place that feels like we have control and the consequences are not going to be too severe. One other suggestion that we have is for you to know your hand signals. So if you folks have been sitting in your desks for a long time, looking at different presentations today, learning lots of things about safety, feel free to stand up and try these from your seat, try them in your seat or stand up and try them just staying right at your desk there. We suggest using our left hand for our hand signals, in part because a lot of folks are right-hand dominant, but actually most importantly because if there's somebody passing us or if there's traffic riding behind us, they will be on our left, and they can see these hand signals well. So take your left hand out and you can signal to turn left. So you signal turning left by sticking your hand right out to your left, which is what that person on the far left side of the screen is doing. And then you can raise your left hand up to a 90 degree angle, and that is your right hand turn. And then you can drop your hand down that same 90 degree angle, but pointing down is a stop. And new in Calgary, you are also allowed to point to the right if you're turning right. So the point of this here is to communicate to other users of the pathways, sidewalks, road systems, and other places that you are on, where you're going to go and where you're going to be, so that people can anticipate where you're going to be, and you can avoid having any crashes or conflicts with other users of the space. Another thing that we suggest as we consider getting out there and making good safety decisions is locking our bike up securely. So one of the risks that we can face in cycling is bike theft. And so you can lock your bike up you can address that risk by locking your bike up. You can, as you can see in this picture, there's good, better, and best. So bike locks come in a bunch of different types. U-locks with cables are one of the more common things. And what we're just looking at here is that if you look at the good one there, the lock is going through the frame of the bicycle and the rear tire, but it's not going through the front tire. And that means that if somebody had the right tools, they could remove your front tire and just steal your front tire. If you locked your bike only through one of the wheels or only through the frame, other parts of your bike also could get stolen. In the middle, this person is using a cable and a U-lock. U-locks are thicker, heavier, strong locks. They've got the U-lock part through the wheel and the frame, and their cable around their front tire. The City of Calgary and Bike Calgary, which is a cycling organization that helps to give tips to people, suggest that you remove your front wheel and attach it through the U-lock. I would argue that that's not particularly necessary unless you're leaving your bike for a long period of time. But what I would always say is there are best practices for how you lock your bike. But what I would always say is lock your bike. Even if you're just running in to grab an ice cream and you're only going to be away from your bike for 5 minutes, always just lock your bike up. Pretty much any lock on the market can be cut by a professional bike thief, which is a bit unfortunate. But what you're trying to do is you're trying to remove the crime of opportunity. So you don't want it to be possible for someone to just walk by, grab your bike, and walk away with it. If you put a lock on, that will really help to prevent the crime of opportunity. Oh, we've got a question. That's great. Do a lot of people steal tires? Why do they take bike tires? Great question. So what the bike parts can also be, bike parts can be used and sold. So I think most bike thieves are probably targeting full bikes, but any part that they can take off. So sometimes people also will steal seats, or they'll steal lights off of bikes or things like that. So you just have to consider where you are. If you've got really good visibility at your bike rack and it's a really high public place with lots of foot traffic, it's probably okay to just lock your bike a bit. But if you're going to leave your bike for a long period of time, it's worth considering what parts of your bike are easy to take off, because people might steal them. Oh, a cheat sheet to stick on your bike. That's a great idea. I don't actually have anything quite like that, but I definitely encourage you to make cheat sheets of the ABC quick check, to make cheat sheets of how to lock your bike up best. All of those kinds of things would be really great. Thanks for the questions, you guys. I really appreciate that. Right. Now we're still out on our bike ride. We got dressed. We made sure our bike is ready to go. We've shared some safety tips. One of the other things that we need to do while we're riding is just assess the hazards in our environment. So we took this screenshot here of just a street in Calgary next to a school. And what I'd love you to do here is write down three hazards that you see in this scene. So if you were riding your bike on the right-hand side of this road, you're traveling towards that pickup truck that's parked in the background there. What do you see here that might be possibly dangerous? The environment that we ride our bike in is often full of lots of hazards, and that's okay. That doesn't mean we shouldn't bike. It just means we should be aware of those possible hazards as we're navigating the environment that we're in. We're looking and listening and paying attention to the world around us as we bike through the scene. All right, so let's go through some of the ones that I see. So we've got a driveway here. So driveways are an interesting hazard because as we're biking down the road, or maybe we're biking on the sidewalk here because that's our comfort level, we might not see other vehicles coming or other people coming as they come out of driveways. So people can walk down their driveways or their sidewalks, or cars can come out of driveways. If you were riding on the sidewalk, you might intersect with a car that's leaving their driveway. So it's just good to notice that there's a driveway ahead and be aware that sometimes cars and people come out of driveway. Speaking of people, we've got a person here playing maybe soccer or something like that in the field. Just good to be aware that maybe they might come over our direction, or they might kick the soccer ball this way accidentally. Again, nothing to be worried about, but just an awareness that if that person does come, sidewalks belong also first and foremost to pedestrians, and so we want to be able to behave safely and predictably around the pedestrian. parked cars. So we see parked cars here. If I was riding on the road, I would want to make sure that I didn't bump into that parked car. The other thing that happens with parked cars is sometimes people get out of them and they open their doors suddenly, and then they might open their door into the roadway, or they might open their door into the sidewalk. And then that's also something we might be able to accidentally bump into. So just being aware of that kind of thing. We just got the curb here. So if you are transitioning on and off of sidewalk, curbs can be a bit of a hazard. So we just want to approach those with caution and safety. We've got some clouds forming in the sky. I wonder if anybody saw that as a possible hazard. So maybe when I left my house, it was nice and sunny and I just jumped on my bike and went for a ride with my friends. But if I'm thinking ahead and I'm aware of some hazards that might be out there, maybe I've got my rain jacket with me. We also know thunderstorms and things like that that can be kind of dangerous. So maybe as I'm looking around, I go, those look like nasty storm clouds, or they might become one. Maybe I'll head home soon to avoid that risk. Or I think I feel good because it is nice and sunny. We've got trees. We've got the natural environment around us that can cause hazards. We've got debris on the road or on the sidewalk. So if you're riding on the pathways or the sidewalks or the roads, there might be debris, broken glass, sticks, loose gravel, things that we could slip on or cause us to have a flat tire. Again, we just want to look. We want to see that it's there and then maybe ride around it or walk our bike over it or just assess whether we think that is a dangerous situation. So those are some of the hazards there. Now we've switched into a questions period, and I think I saw one come in. Which is great. Yeah, here, so we've got a question in the chat box, which is, do we always have to ride our bikes on the road? I feel safer on the pathway. So that's a really good point. I will always encourage you to ride your bike where you feel safe. So pathways and sidewalks are absolutely somewhere where you are allowed to ride your bike. There are actual laws around this kind of stuff here, because when you're young and you are just riding your bike for fun and you're still learning or things like that, you might feel safest on the sidewalk, and that is totally understandable. And that's a totally safe place for you to be. But once you start to get a little bit older and you're more confident on your bike, you can actually ride your bike pretty fast. So I can ride my bike very easily, 30 kilometers an hour or more. And that's pretty fast. That's how fast cars go in a school zone. And so the reason that sometimes we would encourage people to transition to riding on the road eventually, when they're comfortable and when they feel safe to do so, is because bikes are vehicles and they can go efficient and fast, and it becomes unsafe for pedestrians and other users of the sidewalk to have people riding their bikes quickly on the sidewalks. And when I'm getting to work, I want to get there on time, so I go pretty fast on the roads and things like that. And so the actual bylaw in Calgary is that if you are 14 years old or under, you are permitted, you are allowed to ride your bike on the sidewalk. If you are 15 and older, you are technically required to ride your bike on the road. There are roads that are dedicated to cycling. There are roads in Calgary that have cycling infrastructure on them. There's things like bike lanes that have a physical barrier that make it so that you can, that you are separated from the traffic. There's all kinds of painted bike lanes and dedicated bike roads and things like that, that are safer. There's a couple of roads like Deerfoot and things like that where you're not legally not allowed to ride your bike, and I would never ride my bike on busy roads like that. The City of Calgary has really good maps online and in person that show where the dedicated cycling routes are, so that you can ride on roads and routes that are safe and less busy. But I think it's really important, the person asked this question, that I feel safer on the pathway. Listen to that instinct about where you feel safe, and listen to that instinct when you feel hazards are around you. Cars are a huge hazard. Riding on the road is not without its risk. There are absolutely ways to do so safely, and that's something for you to look forward to once you get a little bit older. 15 years and older, you can start to consider riding on the road. But for now, I definitely agree. Ride your bike on the sidewalk and on the bike pathways. Just make sure that when you're doing that, you're aware of the fact that those spaces also belong to pedestrians, and there might be people walking their dogs or people with very young children. or folks who are older or hard of hearing or things like that. And we just want to make sure that we are riding in a way that's safe for everyone who's around us, because bikes can go pretty fast. And so you just want to be cautious and safe when you're riding on the pathways and the sidewalks. But definitely, especially when you're 14 and under, please, please ride your bike where you feel safe. I hope that answered your question. And we definitely still have time for other questions if anybody has any. Otherwise, we're pretty much wrapped up.
Hey, Molly, there was one more.
Oh, great. Did I miss it?
No, it just came in, so I just published it. It's, can you have electric or gas bikes?
Great question. Yeah, so these do exist in all kinds of different conditions. Right now, the only types of assisted bikes that you are legally allowed to ride on sidewalks, bike paths, cycle tracks, and things like that are something that are called pedal assist electric bikes. So I describe these kind of as like if you were riding your bike along and I came up behind you and put my hand on your back and just gave you a gentle push, or the wind was blowing at your back and it was giving you a nice, nice tailwind and making it really easy to bike. So pedal assist electric bikes make it easier for people who have physical barriers to biking long distances. So people can keep cycling for longer. People who have different disabilities and other things like that can access distances more easily. This is really great for like if you live far away from your destination, and they're just kind of fun. But yeah, electric bikes and gas motors are like a little bit less common and a little bit more like you see people kind of getting creative and making their own things. But there's some legality in the city of Calgary where it has to stop at a certain speed limit. Otherwise, it basically just becomes a motorcycle at that point. And then you have to be old enough and you need to have a license and all of those kinds of things. But you can get pedal assist electric bikes that just make biking that little bit more efficient and easy and accessible to people, which is great. I see a couple of other ones coming in, which is great. You don't like your helmet, you have to wear it. Yeah, but yeah, that's fair. Helmets are like not always everybody's favorite thing. I still wear mine every time I ride my bike. But yeah, when you are under 18, it is the law that you wear a helmet. Two people bikes. Yeah, two people bikes are called tandem bikes, and they are definitely legal. They're very fun. It's good to do with someone who you like because it requires some coordination and communication, but they're very much allowed. I have a friend who is blind, and so she can't ride a bike on her own, but her and I go on bike rides together because she has a tandem bike, a two-person bike, and I ride at the front steering, and she sits at the back and just trusts me, and we go on adventures together, mostly around the river on summer days. But yeah, tandem bikes, totally legal, very fun to ride, big fan, highly suggest it. Do you have to carry a spare tire? You can. So because I have the knowledge to do so, I carry a spare inner tube, a patch kit, a pump, and some basic tools on my bike in case something goes wrong with my ABCs, and then I can fix those things while I'm out on the road. You don't have to, it's not a requirement, but if you want to learn how, you absolutely can bring those things with you. So locks, the best kind of locks are U-locks. It's just a category of bike lock, so you could totally look that up or ask for that at a bike shop. They're just the thickest and toughest, and the way they fit around both the frame and the tire. Different people might give you different answers, but that's my perception, and that's the sort of one standard there. Skateboards and scooters, are they allowed on the road? That's a really good question. I'm not 100% sure. I think that they are not. I'm pretty sure that skateboards and scooters are only allowed on sidewalks, bike lanes, and multi-use pathways. I do not believe that skateboards and scooters are allowed on the road, but I'm the bike lady, so I don't quote me on that for sure, but I'm 95% sure that skateboards and scooters are not allowed on the road unless it's in one of those cycle tracks that I was talking about, which is a separated piece of infrastructure from the road. Do you need different bikes in the winter in the mountains? Yeah, I mean, bikes are created with a bunch of different kinds of uses in mind. So this person is asking whether you need different bikes for specific seasons or specific locations. And that is to some degree is true. So for example, you could get a road bike and it's got really skinny, really hard tires, and that those tires are primarily designed only to travel on hard surfaces. So it doesn't do super well in icy or snowy conditions, and it doesn't do really well in the bumpy, muddy conditions of the mountains. So for winter riding or mountain biking, I would get a wider, thicker tire that's got more bumpies on it that are grippy and things like that. So yeah, and there's like a ton of different kinds of bikes. We just talked about some of them. Tandem bikes, you can get bikes that are designed for hauling cargo and they've got these big baskets in it. You've got bikes that are leisurely and more upright position. You've got bikes that are for going really fast and bikes for riding the mountains. There's lots of different types of bikes out there. But I think you can also get too concerned about having the exact perfect bike for the job. A lot of bikes can do a lot of stuff, it's okay to try different things on different bikes. What seasons do you need to change your tires? In the summertime, I ride, it depends on the terrain that you're riding on. Like, are you going to ride on smooth pavement? Or are you going to ride on the grass or the dirt or things like that? But in the wintertime, you can. I ride with just my front wheel has a studded tire on it. So it's got little tiny metal studs that help me grip on the ice. So that's a choice. You don't have to do that, but that is something that I do. I have a winter tire and I have a specific winter bike, but that's in part because wintertime gets really, the roads get really salty and things like that from, and the pathways and stuff, from them laying salt and stuff down on the road, and that can be really hard on your bike. So in the wintertime, I ride a different bike and it gets a bit beaten up by the wintertime, and then I fix it up and I have a different bike that's maybe a little nicer that I ride in the summertime. But that's just a personal choice. Lots of people ride the same bike all year round and just change the tires out or add different features. You can get things like fenders that stop you from getting splashed from the rain. There's lots of really cool little customizations that you can do to your bike to make it suitable to different conditions. It's kind of fun. Thanks so much for the good questions, you guys. That's lovely.
We have one more that just came in.
Great.
So how do you stay safe in falls?
So like if you've crashed your bike, I assume they mean there?
I believe so.
Yeah, that's a really good question. I don't know if I have a really specific answer to that one. Let me stop and think about that. I think first and foremost, as like I said, if you're riding your bike in control, then you can minimize the severity of things like crashes because you're not riding your bike completely out of control. And I think as always, you won't perhaps want to consider the best way to land, or if you're in a situation where you've got one way to swerve into traffic and one way to swerve into the nice open grass, you can make some of those kinds of decisions. But I don't know if I've got a, that's a really good question that I'm going to have to do some more specific searching on to see if there's a good answer to prepare for my next presentation. But I think just mostly for me, it's thinking about being aware of your surroundings and riding your bike in control so that when crashes happen, which they do happen, they happen in a more minor way and are not big catastrophic falls.
Awesome. I don't have any other questions pending at the moment.
Okay.
But I don't know if anyone wants to take a second, but.
Yeah, well, either way, if you and your group are finished, I've got contact information here. If anybody's got any follow-up questions for us or anything else about what Two Wheel View does and what we're up to, but feel free to stay on the call for the next couple minutes and we'll see if any more questions trickle in. But also if you've gotten all your bicycle related questions answered and you're ready to get on with your day, that could be the formal end of our presentation. And I really appreciate you folks coming to join us. And I hope you have lots of fun out there on your bicycle as you go.
Oh, we have one new one that just arrived. What happens if you can't afford a bike but want to learn?
That's great. There's lots of different agencies out there. One of them being like Canadian Tire Jumpstart that will help connect folks to sporting equipment. We work in partnership with a couple of agencies to distribute bikes if there are students who need them, but we don't distribute bikes ourselves. The demand is just too high, unfortunately, and it's not what we are funded for from our programming end. But if there's anybody out there that has a specific question about this, then you could email me at my email address there on the screen, and I can help provide some suggestions. There's a few different avenues depending on the unique situation, but there are some programs and services out there that help to bridge this gap, one of them being Canadian Tire Jumpstart. They do a great job of trying to connect young people to sporting equipment of all kinds, including bicycles.
Amazing. We don't have any other questions pending at the moment.
Okay. Well, thank you so much, everybody. Hopefully we'll see you out there on the bike paths this summer.
Okay, lovely. Thank you everyone for attending. And I think we're going to close out the event now. Have a lovely
day. Bye, everybody.
Bye.